Harper Audio presents Krondor, Tear of the Gods by Raymond E. Feist, performed by Sam Tsoutsouvas. The weather worsened. Dark clouds roiled overhead as angry lightning flashed, piercing the night's blackness on all quarters. The lookout atop the highest mast of the ship Eshop's Dawn thought he saw a flicker of movement in the distance and squinted against the murk. He tried to use his hand to shield his eyes as the salt spray and biting cold wind filled them with tears. He blinked them away, and whatever movement he thought he had seen was gone. In the hold below, eight monks of the Temple of Eshop in Krondor stood around a most holy artifact, the Tear of the Gods. A jewel of astonishing size, easily as long as a large man's arm and twice as thick, it was illuminated from within by a mystic light. Once every 10 years, a new tier was formed in a hidden monastery in a tiny secret valley in the Grey Tower Mountains. When it was ready, and most holy rites completed, a heavily armed caravan transported it to the nearest port in the free cities of Natal. There it was placed upon a ship and carried to Krondor. From there, the tier and an escort of warrior monks, priests, and servants would continue on, eventually reaching Salador, to then be taken by ship and transported to the Mother Temple in Rillinan, where it replaced the previous tier as its power waned. The true nature and purpose of the sacred gem was known only to the highest ranking among those serving within the temple, and the sailor high atop the mainmast asked no questions. He trusted in the power of the gods and knew that he served a greater good. He was being handsomely paid not to ask questions, as much as to stand his watch. He was pulled from his reverie by another flicker of movement toward shore. Light from the ship painted the storm-tossed combers, and he could sense the rhythm of the sea. Something had just broken the rhythm. He peered through the murk, trying to pierce the gloom by strength of will, to see if they might be drifting too close to the rocks. Newt said, "The blue light coming from that ship gives me a bad feeling, Captain." The man Newt addressed towered over him. At 6'8" tall, Bear dwarfed those around him. His massive shoulders and arms lay exposed by the black leather cuirass he favored, though he had added a pair of shoulder pads studded with steel spikes. An amulet hung around his neck, bronze but darkened by more than time and neglect, stained by ancient and black arts. The red gem set in its middle pulsed with a faint inner light of its own. The exposed skin displayed dozens of reminders of battles fought. A scar ran from forehead to jawbone through his right eye, which was milky white. But his left seemed to glow with an evil red light, and Newt knew that eye missed little.
"Worry about keeping us off the rocks, pilot," Bear said. "It's the only reason I keep you alive."
Turning to the rear of the ship, he spoke softly, but his voice carried to the stern.
"Now!"
A sailor at the rear spoke down to those in the hold below. "Forward!" And the hortator raised one hand and then brought its heel down on the drum between his knees. At the sound of the first beat, the slaves chained to their seats raised their oars, and on the second beat, they lowered them and pulled as one. The word had been passed, but the master of slaves who walked between the banks of oars repeated it.
"Silently, my darlings, I'll kill the first of you who makes a sound above a whisper."
The ship inched forward, picking up speed. At the prow, Newt crouched, intently scanning the water before him. He had never been so frightened in his life. He was a born pirate, a dock rat from Port Natal, who had worked his way up from being an ordinary seaman to being one of the best pilots in the bitter sea. Newt felt Bear standing behind him. He had worked for the enormous pirate before, once taking Quigan prize ships as they returned from raids along the Keshian coast. Newt knew he was likely to die tonight. Since Bear had expropriated Newt's crew, it had simply been a matter of time. Something had changed Bear, made him far blacker a soul than before. He had always been a man of few scruples, but there had been an economy in his business, a reluctance to waste time with needless killing and destruction, even if he was otherwise unfazed by it. Now Bear seemed to relish it. Bear had made one thing clear above all else. This mission's goal was to take a holy relic from the Eshapians, and any man who interfered with that mission would die. But he had also promised that the crew could keep all the rest of the Eshapian treasure for themselves. When he heard that, Newt had begun to make a plan. Newt had insisted upon several practice sorties, claiming that the tides and rocks here were treacherous enough in the daylight. At night, 1,000 calamities could befall the unprepared. Bear had grudgingly acquiesced to the plea. What Newt had hoped would happen did. The crew learned to take orders from him once Bear gave over command of the ship. Bear's crew was made up of thugs, bullies, and murderers, including one cannibal, but they weren't terribly intelligent. Newt's was a daring plan, and dangerous, and he needed more than a little luck. He gauged his distance and the motion, then turned and shouted past Bear,
1 point to port! Ramming speed!
Bear echoed the command,
ramming speed!
Then he shouted,
catapults! Ready!
Flames appeared as torches were quickly lit, and then those torches were put to large bundles of skins full of Quigan fire oil. They burst into flame, and the catapult officer shouted,
ready, Captain!
Bear's deep voice rumbled as he gave the order,
fire!
The lookout squinted against the wind-driven salt spray. He was certain he saw something shoreward. Suddenly a flame appeared. Then a second. For a moment, size and distance were difficult to judge. But the sailor quickly realized with a surge of fear that 2 large balls of fire sped toward the ship. Angry orange-red flames sizzled and cracked as the first missile arced overhead, missing the lookout by mere yards. As the fireball shot past, he could feel the searing heat.
Attack!
He shouted at the top of his lungs. The second fireball struck mid-decks, hitting the companionway that ran from below to the foredeck, and an unfortunate priest of Ishap was consumed in the sticky flames. He screamed in agony and confusion as he died. The sailor knew that if they were being boarded, staying aloft was not a good idea. He swung from the crow's nest and slid down a stay sheet to the deck below as another ball of flame appeared in the sky, arcing down to strike the foredeck. As his bare feet touched the wooden planks, another sailor who shouted, Quigan Raiders! Handed him a sword and buckler shield. The thudding of a hortator's drum echoed across the waves. Suddenly the night came alive with noise and cries. From out of the gloom a ship reared, lifted high by a huge swell, and the 2 sailors could see the massive serrated iron ram extending from the galley's prow. Once it slammed into its victim's hull, its teeth would hold the rammed ship close until the signal was given for the galley slaves to reverse their stroke. By backing water, the galley would tear a massive hole in Ishap's Dawn's side, quickly sending her to the bottom. The ship heaved, and the sound of tearing wood and shrieking men filled the night as the raider crashed into the Eshapian ship. The lookout and his companions were thrown to the deck. As the lookout rolled away from the spreading fire, he saw 2 hands gripping the ship's gunwale. The lookout gained his feet as a dark-skinned pirate cleared the side of the ship and boarded with a leap to the deck, others following. Then the lookout's eyes widened as he saw another figure rear up behind the first. It was the last thing the lookout saw as the first pirate swung his sword and impaled him. With his dying breath, he gasped,
Bear!
Bear glanced around the deck. Massive hands flexed in anticipation as he spoke.
You know what I'm after? Everything else is yours for the taking.
Newt leaped from the raider's craft to stand at Bear's side.
We hit him hard, so you don't have much time,
he shouted to the crew. As Newt had hoped, Bear's men rushed to kill the Eshapian sailors. while Newt signaled to the handful from his old crew, who headed toward the hatches and the cargo nets. An Ishapian monk, climbing up the aft companionway to answer the alarm, saw the pirates spreading out in a half-circle around him. His brothers followed after. For a moment, both sides stood motionless as they measured one another. Bear stepped forward, and in a voice like grinding stone said to the first monk,
"You there! Bring me the tear, and I'll kill you quickly!"
The monk's hands came up and moved rapidly in a mystic pattern while enchanting a prayer to summon magic. The other monks took up fighting stances behind him. A bolt of white energy flashed at Bear, but vanished harmlessly just inches before him. With a scornful laugh, Bear said,
"Your magic means nothing to me."
With surprising speed for a man his size, Bear lashed out with his sword. The monk, still recovering from the shock of his magic's impotence, stood helpless as Bear ran him through. The pirates let loose a roar of triumph and fell upon the other monks. The monks, though empty-handed and outnumbered, were all trained in the art of open-handed fighting. In the end, they could not stand up to pole weapons and swords, knives and crossbows, but they delayed the pirates long enough that the forecastle was already underwater before Bear could reach the companionway leading below decks. Like a rat through a sewer grating, Newt was past Bear and down the companionway. Bear came second, the others behind.
"We've got no time!"
shouted Newt, looking around the aft crew quarters. Newt could hear water rushing into the hole below the forecastle. He knew ships. Eventually a bulkhead between the forecastle and the main cargo hold would give way, and then the ship would go down like a rock. A small wooden chest sitting in the corner caught his eye, and he made straight for it, while Bear moved to a large door that led back to the captain's cabin. Movement was becoming more difficult as the deck was now tilting, and walking up its slick surface was tricky. More than one pirate fell, landing hard upon the wooden planks. Newt opened the small chest, revealing enough gems to keep him in luxury for the rest of his life. Like moths to a flame, several raiders turned toward the booty. Newt motioned to two other pirates close by and said,
"If you want a copper for all this slaughter, get up on deck, help open the hatch, and lower the cargo net."
Both men hesitated, then looked to where Bear struggled to open the door. They glanced at one another, then did as Newt instructed. Newt knew they would find two of his men already at the hatch and would fall in to help. Bear was smashing himself uphill against a door that obviously had some sort of mystic lock upon it, for it hardly moved under his tremendous bulk. Newt cast a quick glance backward and saw the wood near the hinges splintering. As he lowered himself into the hold, Newt looked down. He knew that there was enough treasure below to make every man aboard a king, for the odd man named Sidi, who had hired Bear for this job, had said that 10 years' worth of temple wealth from the far coast and free cities would accompany the magic item Bear was to bring him. Newt regretted having met Sidi. When he had first met him, he had no idea the so-called traitor trafficked in the magic arts. Once he had discovered the truth, it was too late. And Newt was certain there was far more to Sidi than was obvious. Sidi had given Bear his magic amulet, the one that he refused to remove day or night. Newt had always stayed away from magic, temple, wizard, or witch. He had a nose for it, and it made him fearful. And no man in his experience reeked of it like Sidi, and there was nothing tender about that reek. The cargo hatch above moved, and a voice shouted downward,
"Newt!"
"Lower away!" commanded the little thief. The cargo net descended, and Newt quickly released it.
"Get down here!"
he shouted as he spread the large net across the center of the deck.
"We're taking on water, fast!"
4 sailors slid down ropes and started moving the heavy cargo chests to the center of the net.
"Get the small ones first," instructed Newt. "There'll be gems, worth more than gold, pound for pound."
One of the men paused to listen to the fiendish shout as Bear finally smashed through the door. A half dozen pirates, finished with butchering the ship's crew, descended the ropes from the deck above and looked questioningly at the pilot. Newt said,
The captain said everything was ours for the taking if he got that damn stone the priests were guarding. You're gonna let all this sink?
They shook their heads and set to, working in pairs to move the larger chests and sacks into the nets, although Newt could see the doubt on their faces. But they hurried and got most of the booty in the net and tied it off.
Haul away! Newt shouted to the men above.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.